composting is worm composting, and really there's two essential things you need besides the worms, and that is a bin and a composter for in your house. And you can get something fancy like this. Personally, I just use a pitcher and I put my food in that, a plastic pitcher, and I take that outside. But this one here has aeration holes and a large open space for your food. And so you can put your food scraps inside a bin like this and take it out to a composting system. This here is a multi-tiered worm composting system. It's called Can of Worms and it's from Australia. The multi-tiers allow for worms to migrate upwards and you can harvest the worm castings below. And so right now in this composting system, the worms are on the second level. And you'll see in here, this is about to be ready to be harvested. This is very dense worm castings that is this dark matter. One of the main benefits of using worms to break down your food are the castings that are left behind. This is the dark organic matter that is in my hands right now. And this matter actually contains more iron, zinc, copper, nitrogen, potassium, and phosphorus than many fertilizers you can buy at the store. And you'll see in this layer right now, the worms are actually slightly reddish in color. And this is the type of worm you'll want to use if you start worm composting at home. These are called red wigglers. And you can see them all here in my hand. And so red wigglers actually contain over, or can consume over double their mass in body weight a day. And so they're really good for breaking down your food. There are some essential items you need, like a composter by your kitchen sink and the actual compost bin. And then the worms. There are several places you can order worms. If you look online, you can find red wigglers and you can order them in the mail, actually. And there's actually a couple places in Salt Lake where you can get worms as well. And so once you have the worms in the bin, what you need to do is put together an actual set of items that the worms need to survive. The first is bedding. And I personally use newspaper, shredded newspaper. You can use shredded office paper, cardboard. Some people use coconut mulch. There's several items that you can use for the actual bedding. And the actual moisture of the bedding should be about that of a wet sponge, but not soaked. So just think of a sponge that you've had by the kitchen sink and you squeeze it out. What's left behind, the way that feels is how your worm compost should feel. And what else the worms need to survive are some form of grit. So that could be dirt or coffee grinds. Anything along that nature that they can use to help digest the food. And of course you need food, so that's the main purpose for you to help cut down your food waste. So food scraps that the worms can eat. Here's a pea pod and an avocado. In general, worms don't like really spicy food, so that would include onions, heavy spices like cayenne pepper, and garlic, etc. So you don't want to overload your compost on things like that. And they also don't digest meat, so you don't want to put a lot of meat in your compost. So you need the vegetables, and the last is some form of moisture. And so I explained that with the sponge analogy. And once you have those items, you can just put them in your bin, put the worms in there, and get started. And this is a very fancy bin that was ordered in the mail. It's a multi-tiered bin, like I explained, but you can also order or buy at the grocery store a simple tote, a Rubbermaid tote, and drill holes. A very important aspect of your worm compost is that the worms have holes so that they get enough oxygen to survive. And so that average tote at the grocery store, Rubbermaid tote, would cost about $5. And ordering worms, if you were to order worms, for example, in Salt Lake, you can order 2 dozen worms for $4. So they're actually very cheap. They're the same worms that are used for fishing. When your worm compost gets to the point where it's mostly worm castings, that's the dark organic matter that we see here, you're ready to harvest the castings. And How you do that, on a multi-tiered system like this, you would put fresh food and bedding on the next layer above. The worms will naturally migrate upwards onto the next layer, and then you can harvest the castings below. Another thing you can do with a worm system like this, with holes on the multiple levels, is harvest tea from below. So this is a good example of worm tea. This is a mixture of the worm castings and water. And this sits in the bottom of this composting system. And then you harvest the worm tea by turning this tap and it comes out the bottom. It's best if you can aerate your worm tea. And so you want to stir it for, on average, about 8 hours, about once every hour or 2 hours. Just stir it and keep aerating that tea. And then you can use it in your garden. And how this worm tea works, it's like liquid fertilizer. And so you're applying that to your garden and it really helps boost your plant growth. And so you'll see this is really light in coloration. So what I'll want to do is just take a handful, make sure I'm not killing any worms in doing that. And I'll throw some of that in and mix it with my hand. And what you'll have here, what you see, is some really powerful liquid fertilizer now that you can use in your garden. You can also apply the castings to your garden, but I'll warn you that they are so dense in nitrogen that you'll actually want to put the castings around your plants instead of touching your plants directly, because it might over-fertilize the plants. So red wigglers, which are the most common worm that you would use in your worm composting system, survive best at a temperature range between 55 and 77 degrees Fahrenheit. So what that means for most Utahns is that this would be inside your house. Luckily, worm compost has more of an earthy smell than a typical composting system because of the worm castings. And so that keeps down a lot of the barriers homeowners have with composting, is that the smell isn't that bad if you do this in your house. If you have a worm compost outside, you could keep it out there certain times of the year. And if your compost pile is large enough that it's generating its own heat, you could also have your worms in there over the winter. But it just depends on how large your compost is. So another benefit of worm composting, as opposed to regular composting, is that worm composting has an earthy smell. You don't get the composting or breaking down smell of regular food that you would get in a regular compost. Instead, these castings, they have a real soily, earthy type smell to them. And a way to cut down on smell if you're to compost, a lot of people have their worm compost inside their house. And the way that they do that is when they put fresh food scraps in the bin, let's say this avocado shell is fresh, I would actually pull some dirt aside and bury that underneath, and then you don't have any smell from that food breaking down. The worms will take care of that underneath the layer of soil. And that's the best way to keep the smell down in your own house.